thank you very much for, I'd like to thank Hong Kong U for inviting me here, especially when they're celebrating 100 years of teacher education. I just want to start off by saying that I'm not an academic, I'm a practitioner. So what I'm sharing with you will be how we have translated the research from all the academics, right, into our policy and programs so that we can make impact on the practice and learning. Right, just like all practitioners, let me do a reflection of what I've learned the last 1.5 days. We started off with a presentation by Lee Shuman. I must also say that while I've read a lot of the books, I've heard a lot, it's a different interaction at this symposium. Our initial understanding of PCK was actually from Lee Shuman's work. I can resonate fully with his work when he shared that PCK is not just about content, it's also about context, culture, and community. This is a lovely shift because when I first studied his work, the initial PCK construct was based on cognitive theory. This is indeed a great need. There's indeed a great need for motivation, effect, and emotion. We must teach our fellow professionals to teach, to improve ourselves as educators, support and improve the work of professionals, and to serve society more fully. And I can truly also resonate the pedagogical professional knowledge. I really love the habits of the mind, habits of the practice, and habits of the heart. Teaching is not about teaching our subject, it's about touching lives. So it's very different. Reflective practitioners, it's very important for us to constantly reflect on our work as educators, to look back at what we have done well and how to improve, to learn, to celebrate, and to regret. I believe that it's an inner desire of every teacher to want to teach well, and the worst thing is to end a lesson with a bell. Right, so there were times where we teach and we hope that the bell will never go because we really engage our students, and there were times where we felt very lousy and we were wondering why the bell has not gone. And we know this feeling because all of us have experienced it and we know what it's like. He also mentioned about brain surgeon versus teachers. I would also like to say that while the doctor heals the body, the teacher heals the soul. The panel discussion, we touched on a number of important pieces of work, reskilling and upgrading, and how we work at the micro, meso, and macro level. The key role of a teacher is to utilize student participation in building knowledge, and we felt emotional when we discussed on the topic on helping our students from the marginalized groups. All of us, we encounter them. It's a belief of every educator that every child is important, every child can learn and achieve. We may not be able to help 100% of the children, but every child we can help will make a very big difference to his family and society. On this note, I would like to share that I have the privilege in Singapore to be able to be the founding principal of a school. It's called the North Light School. Because we have a group of children who, for whatever reason, cannot clear the primary school leaving exams. And we kept repeating. And at around 2006, 2007, we felt that it's time for us to look after this group of kids. They need a different curriculum, a different pedagogy to reconnect with them. They come from very difficult homes, but if we do not help them, one will, right? Because the family won't. So in 2006, I would say that we conceptualized a school for them. And I was in this very big project team, and we were all there and to be a resource person. I was a resource person. Resource person is very easy. You just give feedback. And you just give your input. Then we came a time when we needed someone to head the school. But I would like to say that deep inside me, I have this great passion for the children. But what I do not have is experiential empathy. Because I don't come from families like that, I do not be able to understand them. And I remember on a Tuesday night when I went back home for dinner, I told my dad about it. And he said, "Did ministry give you a choice?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Don't take it up, it's too tough for you." Then when I went home, I shared with my husband, and he said that if your internal GPS asks you to do something, then do it. So between my husband and my father, of course, I listen to him. He's with me every day, my father, once a week. Right, so what happened then was, I would like to say that while I said that, I did recently, there's this great apprehension that, can I really help the children? So what happened then was, at one big meeting, there was a discussion, and the permanent secretary asked, how many teachers do you need for 2007 for the ministry to push? So at that time, I was thinking that I could be in my fairy tale mood. And I said, I do not want teachers to be posted. I want teachers to apply. He says, that's very good. I write the meter down everything. And on my way home, I was wondering, what happened if nobody applied? I don't have any more teachers. And I said, why did I say that at the meeting? You know. So then what happened was, they said that I will give you a dedicated platform for you to recruit. So what happened was, they given me a venue that can take this capacity, about maybe this section. But deep inside me, I felt that I don't think so many people will apply. And if there are about 40 people in such a big auditorium, they look very miserable. And even the 40 may not feel like applying. So I changed the venue. But I need to give each other a very good reason why I changed the venue. So I changed another venue to about like 100 capacity, because that particular venue is very close to an MRT station. That was the reason I gave, but that was not the real reason behind it. On that day, 150 people turned up. I was just amazed. First, I was so ashamed of myself. I have no faith in my own fraternity and no confidence. And they had to sit on the steps on the floor because there was no space to even put in additional chairs. So when I look at the 150 in front of me, and I made 20 for the first year, I told myself, it will definitely work. Why? Because the core theory of success is the collective relationship of this group of teachers. All right, with the same passion, have the competence to help this group of children. And now it's about 11 years, and I would say that many of the students are working. Just to share with you two stories. The first one was in 2007 with a very good, very generous sponsor who actually sponsored every kid with a cup of Ben and Jerry ice cream. So to this group of children, it's really a treat because it's quite expensive for them. So one recess, the Ben and Jerry van turned into the school, and they were all so surprised. All right, and they were given. Now, one of the boys who received this cup of ice cream has started a very small scuba diving school. And the last 2 years, on Children's Day, he brought back 900 cups of ice cream. And he told the students, I would like you to experience what I've experienced 10 years ago. And he actually told the students, you look at the cup of ice cream, there's nothing great, but there's something great behind the story of this ice cream. So it was such a great motivation factor and inspiration factor for our teachers, better than the performance bonus and promotion. All right, because this intrinsic affirmation will rest in the teacher for a very long time. There was another incident. Now I understood why my father asked me that if I had a choice, if they did that, I'm going to take it out. There was another boy, he came from a very difficult home. And in my first year as a principal, he did not turn up for school for 3 months. But he has a wonderful form teacher who visited him 12 times. And one day I told the form teacher, 12 times, I think it's a lot. Then I asked him, how about you just give up? Can you imagine I'm the principal? And I said, if you know there's so many students in school, how can we help? Would there be a situation where a child cannot be helped? He said, let me try a few more times. Now, what happened then was, because this boy, he was so ashamed that the teacher kept coming, and he told the classmate, if you know when Mr. Chan is coming, please tell me. I want to get out of the house because I'm too ashamed to see me. So the friends would call him up and say, Francis, he has three periods at 9 o'clock. Maybe he's coming. Then he'll jump out of bed, grab his seat, and just left, you know, we'll just leave the house, hide behind this pillar there until the teacher left. And he will know, because every time when this teacher would visited him. This teacher will get his favorite McDonald's meals, and if he's not in, he will hang it at the metal gate, the door handle. So what happened was one day, the 14th time, 12th time to the teacher, he had thought of giving up, So 14th time he came back. But because he didn't come to school for 3 months, there's no chance to see me. Then I started my lectures and says, wow, the teacher must send invitation for you to come to school. All right, and if you want to learn how to help me, I went on and on until one, just at the moment I paused, he said, Sistra, I want to tell you something. I've never come across a teacher who has never given up hope on me. And you know how tiring it is? 8 o'clock, we see a phone call. 9 o'clock, we see a phone call. 9:30, we see a phone call. If my teacher doesn't give up, I give up. He came back to school, and he was on track, and he graduated from the school with a perfect score of GPA 4.0. This is a situation where, as teachers, we do not give up because we don't know when the child will turn around. Right? So because I noticed that there are a number of teachers here, I just keep my presentation to ensure that whatever I share can be a source of encouragement for you. Pastor Selberg also reminded us of the importance of having quality control at the entry level and the belief in our profession. The future will be very uncertain, very volatile, with the disruptive technology. And to prepare our students for the 21st century learners, we must be 21st century educators. Right, at the second panel discussion yesterday, we covered teachers being the agent of change, how teachers need to understand the community before we can serve them. We also know that that is very important. Just now, Andy shared with us on the importance of collaborative professionalism. Teachers do not collaborate because they say they have no time, so we need to create the time and space for them to collaborate. And we also focus on the strong fundamentals just now, literacy, numeracy, social-emotional competency, and future learning at our panel, and the importance of mentoring. It's very important for us to talk about collective, quality relationship, and we also touch on well-being, public confidence, and how to build a clear narrative and story, not only within our community, but also beyond. So that's a very brief reflection of what we have covered. Maybe here, we just share with you, Singapore is a very small country. It's also a city, it's also a nation, it's everything. All right, it's only about 720 square kilometers, and because of our size, there's a lot of advantages, because we can reach out to everyone, our educators, very fast. What happened also, this is my outline of the presentation. Let me also share our journey. We started off way back then, all right, when we became self-governing. It was a very difficult period. It was a survival period. And we had mass education, prepare people for industrialization. And at this period, we also experienced, this period here, we experienced high attrition. We have high enrollment, there's also high attrition. For example, if you take a primary one, that's grade one, all the way to sec 4, that is grade 10, that when they sit for the O level, the attrition during that period of time is actually about 40%. For a very small country like Singapore, without natural resources, our only resource is the people. Everyone is very important to us. All right, everyone we can help is very important. Everyone we cannot help is also very important. Okay, then we have the efficiency driven, where we just have to make progress and make sure we reduce the attrition rate. Later we find that we are all okay, our advantages are in place, and that is where we are able to have a bit more untidiness. We do not have a one size fits all, which I later share with you. And this was also the period where the Northlight School got conceptualized. Northlight, the school corporate colors are purple and white. Purple is the color of the sky when it's darkest, and white is the color of the stars. We always remind our teachers and students that the darker it gets, the brighter it shines. Right? Your problems will still be with you, but you will be able to cope. All right, then we have this stage where we have values driven, student-centric. It's not like we do not have values here, but it's just that it's very important for our students and our teachers to understand the importance of values. We encourage our teachers to let go a bit, allow our students to experience failure while they're in school. That's the safest place to fail, all right? And learn from the experience. Not every experience is a pleasant experience, but every experience is a learning experience. We do not need to have a perfect product all the time. It's not about process and product, it's about process and progress. Okay, so let me just share a bit. So the role of education is two roles, economy as well as aspiration. Let me share with our education system briefly. Everyone goes through primary six. We have a school leaving exams. To many of the parents and the students, this is a very important exam because after this, they will go to the different part in the secondary school. And we often remind our students that your parents' love for you is not proportional to the T-score that you have for your primary school leaving exam. Your parents' love for you is because they love you, you are their children. So that is where some of our students are not able to move on. Now, I just want to say that we have 40% attrition. I mentioned today in the 1970s. Now, 40 years on, our attrition is actually below 1%. It's 0.7, right? And that's important to us. So when they finish, they can go to the secondary school. Okay, so during that ability-driven part, we can have a bit of untidiness. We have a group of schools where the students do not need to sit for the O-level. They can just go straight to the A-level. And also, this part here, because we do not want our parents to be so obsessed with the results, we have this thing called direct school admission, where even if you do not fulfill the cutoff for that school, but you are able to show your passion, your aptitude in a particular niche area that that school value, the school will take you. All right? We also have specialized independent schools, like our schools for the arts, sports schools, and our maths and science. Okay, I mentioned North Lights here. Okay? And now, while we first started, I think my confidence level was not very high. We had to actually present this to say what, and I was just telling them that we will bring down the attrition for this group of children from 60% to 25%. Then, my first year, when the first group of students graduated, it was 14. But I thought that it was just flu or just novelty, and I still hold on to 20% at least. But it has stabled, plateaued at 14. And because the number is small, we are able to have this group. When the number is big, it's tough. Okay, and 12 of them have already now completed this stage, which is here, they're completed here, right? Which is actually meant for the O-level students. Okay, so ultimately, it's about work and life. It's not about the paper qualification. Everyone needs to go through work and life. If you have no strong character, you don't have the attitude, you are not ready for work. Right? So the work and life here is very important. And later on, I'll talk about this lifelong learning. Okay, let me just briefly go through this part about breadth, depth, and length. It's very important for us to the breadth is broad-based. In our earlier years, they are all broad-based. They don't specialize. It's only later we do. And the depth is about character values, and it's about learning for life and learning throughout life. All right, later the part, I will cover this as well. Now, this is a very important framework. Every teacher in Singapore knows of this framework. And sometimes they will tell you that this is our Swiss role. All right, if you ask them, do you know the Swiss rule diagram, they will tell you yes. And this is our 21st century competency with values right in the center. Respect, responsibility, resilience, integrity, care, and harmony is rich, R-I-C-H, right? Here is the social-emotional learning that is very important. For For example, the children in my previous school, while they understand themselves, sometimes they do not know how to manage. I'm not an anger management, but I don't know how to, I'm not a problem with my anger management, but I don't know how to go about doing. So this part is important, and this is indeed very important. It's our 21st century competency. Civics, literacy, global awareness is when our students get out, you'll find that they will get to work with people that they are very different. They must know how to work with them. Critical and inventive thinking, communication, collaboration, and information skills. Right, how you collaborate, communicate, and this. And our syllabuses are designed around this. In Singapore, we have a centralized system for curriculum. Our curriculum cycle is 6 years, with a midterm review every 3rd year. Rather than there's a review, the teachers have no choice but to go for professional learning, because if not, they will not be able to deliver the curriculum. And these are outcomes that we'd like to see in our students. Okay, this is what we believe in, and we strongly believe in this. All right, let me share with you about this journey, our recruitment. We managed to recruit, managed to attract the top 1/3 of our graduate to join teaching, okay? It's not just about results, we have to look at their co-curricular activities and also their community service, community involvement program. But that's not enough. After we have shortlisted them, we will put them through an interview, but before that, they are also required to present a 5 to 10 minute lesson preparation presentation. You know, there are some of these potential teachers, they come for the interview. They are very good, but you cannot have eye contact. They start looking at the, just look at the floor. Now, if you are not able to present to a 3 to 4 member panel, you cannot teach in front of a class of 30 or 40, right? So we let them through. They are not looking at the really complex, they are untrained, but it's just their disposition. They'll go to an interview. When they clear the interview, they'll be sent to the school for about 3 to 6 months, and we call this contract teaching. Right? This is a very important period for them to ask themselves, is teaching for me? It's also for the schools to look at this teacher and say, is teaching for this person? So we have a lot of teachers, so-called, all right, they have stellar results, but they do not have the disposition of a teacher. They are very impatient with the children. They can understand, but they just ask the children, I don't see why you cannot see it. You know, it's so clear and you cannot see it. And the kids will get very frightened or frustrated, or some just don't like kids, or some of them say, I cannot stand noise. We in school, you cannot have a noise-free environment, right? So what happened then is that if it's a very important period for us. We need to be cruel to be kind. Because you know what happened? The moment they enter NIE, they are considered an employee of MOE. We pay them to study in NIE. We do our manpower planning right from here. It means we project about 8 years, 8 to 10 years, how many teachers we need and what type of teachers we need. So it won't be a situation where the teachers come out from NIE and they cannot find a school. Because all students in NIE, they are employee of MOE. And we also tell them, don't compare yourself with NTU. Why the students, the undergrads can put on slippers, why we cannot? Because we are employee of MOE. And our ethos and code of conduct kicks in right from the start. So the moment they enter here, and if they cannot complete, it will be a very painful experience for them. Because they have to pay the LD. And that's very hard. So this is a very critical period. The moment they don't step into here, it's fine. Right? It's for them to ask themselves. Because, well, you can put up a show for 1 week, 2 weeks, but I think 6 months is quite a long time. You know, if you don't have it, it will show naturally. Then after that, I'll share a little bit about the beginning teachers. Okay, on this note, I'll just share with you an object lesson. Now, you have this book. Okay? You find that many of our teachers, they come in like that, even before they go for teacher preparation, right? But at teacher preparation, they find that, it's not that bad. I know a bit of something. You see? But that's not enough. Our definition of teacher education is, it's not teacher preparation, but it's throughout the teaching. So it's not just about this, or about this, but it's about this. So if you practice your power of observation, you will know how to go about this. It's not rocket science. Okay, about 50% of the achievement depends on the students, 30% depends on the teachers, and that's why we invest a lot. We have our teacher growth model. You will notice that in the teacher growth model, we develop our whole training roadmap in the teacher's growth model. There are five dimensions. It's not enough just being a competent professional. It's not enough. You have to be an ethical educator. Our teachers also do research. We have to be true to the integrity of the data. We need to ask for permission, all right? And then to follow the whole thing. And also, as teachers, they may be involved in procurement financial procedure. We are not spending our own money, we are spending taxpayer money. We need to observe the standard operating procedure. This area, we do not want it to be too creative, all right? We should not shortchange and look for the easy way out, take shortcut. A computer professional is, of course, important in the classroom. A collaborative learner, later I'll talk about our communities. Later, if they become teacher leaders, they will become a transformation leader, and we cannot exist alone, a community builder. This is a very simplistic diagram, but just give you a good picture of how it goes. We have the five outcomes here, and we have the different dimensions here. You can imagine that in the different stages of a teacher journey, let's say a beginning teacher, we have one lot of this. Experienced teacher, we have another lot. Then senior teacher, another group. So it's like a matrix, alright? There are some courses that are core, some are optional, and later I'll explain a little bit more. Alright, let me share with you. It's a very unique feature in Singapore that we have three tracks. We started off, as everybody started off as a classroom teacher. Oh, by the way, every one of us in the professionally in the ministry must be an educator. Alright, that is something that it is in our ministry. And what happened then is that for us to go in and out of HQ ministry and out to school is a very common phenomena. For example, I've teaching in history, I've teaching in schools, and even master teachers like Cedric, Maylin, they are all educators. And for our teachers to come to a stay in history and work is very common. Principles, very common. Right? So we have experienced both policy formulation and policy implementation, which means that the chances of us formulating a policy that cannot be implemented is low, right? So we have experienced that. And when we grow up, no one can say that we do not know what's happening. So at least in my 6 years in the school, and just one school and previous school, at least are strict credibility, right? No teacher will say that we don't understand. Okay, so here, we have three tracks. In the beginning, the very long, long ago, when I was teacher, there was only one track, that's a leadership track. But we realized that there are teachers who just do not want to be administrator. And they just do not like to be administrator, but they are excellent teachers. So we say, okay, if you are excellent teachers, and you like to continue to work with students and teachers, remain in the teaching track. So Maylin is a principal master teacher, Cedric is a master teacher, and you find that the principal master teacher can have a sub-grade equivalent to a senior principal of the school. So basically, we are saying this, just do what you are best at and enjoy doing it, right? Then of course, leadership track will be here, specialist track. These are the people in curriculum planning, our education psychologists, these are the ones who spend, I would say, well, longer in HQ, but these tracks at the lower level is, that means you can cross tracks. Okay? Currently, I have five master teachers who are formerly vice principal. So one of them shared with me that I think I'm above average vice principal, but I think I can be an outstanding master teacher. But they need to go through the accreditation. They need to go through a portfolio. It's quite rigorous, all right, the process, but you enjoy doing what you are best at. So we have these three tracks. And for us in the academy, we are the champions for the teaching track. Okay, and even the master teachers, while they spend 50% working with schools, they also spend about 20% to 25% teaching in the classroom to show what good teaching looks like. Okay, so this is one of the quote that illustrates this part about we must teach our fellow professionals to teach, improve ourselves as teachers, which we talked about it earlier, support and improve the work of professionals, and to serve the society more fully. Right, this illustrates that. Senior teacher, the responsibility is mainly in the schools. Lead teachers, schools, and the clusters. Our schools are divided into clusters, right, about 40 schools per cluster, and they're divided into zones. And the master teachers, responsibility at the zonal and national level, and the master teachers and the principal teachers, their base is with the academies, these two schools. But having said that, they do work. Okay, this philosophy is very important to us. Teacher ownership and teacher leadership. This is a very fundamental philosophy for the academies. Right? We have to own our own professional learning, and this teacher-led. It's for teacher by teacher. In every school, there is a very important person. It's called the school staff developer. It's a larger department. And these school staff developers stay very closely to us. They are kept very close in our radar because they help the principals and the vice principals to plan for the professional development for the school. So all the changes that we have in the learning, we have to talk about PLCs, right? And you know PLCs when implemented is very uneven. But we actually equip the school staff developers with tools of critical inquiry so that the chances of them doing the right thing is higher. There are seven academies, the biggest here, and this has done, so I'm performing two roles. So I'm the ED of ASD, so I'm here, but because I'm also the DY, DGE for PD, I look after everybody. Right, so just explain a bit of the structure. We have a Director General of Education. Under him, there are three of us. We have one deputy DG in charge of schools, one in charge of curriculum and charge of professional development, and we meet once every fortnight to ensure that there's complete alignment in whatever we do. So even for curriculum, I mentioned to you about the review, right? The review of our curriculum. A member of NIE, the National Institute of Education, is a member of that and also a master teacher. So that at the conceptualization of the curriculum, all parties are involved. So it won't be a situation where the student teacher come out and say, that was not what we were taught. So it won't be like that. It's very aligned. So you see you have MOE doing policy, NIE will be the research and preparation, and school the practice. Just share with you a change that we have made. We actually do graduate preparedness surveys. That means when a teacher graduate from NIE after teacher preparation, 9 months later we will administer a survey. We will ask the beginning teachers, all right, what is it in your teacher preparation that has helped you to do this, what you want to do earlier better? We also ask the principals and the heads of department, you look at this beginning teacher, is it equipped for the first 2 years of teaching and things like that? And we found that many of them said that they lack the teaching practice and they would want to have more. So the first group of teachers matriculated in December 2016, we now have changed our teacher education, our initial teacher education for the PGDE from 12 months to 16 months. Now that's a very big thing because there's a lot of implication on finance, HR, and things like that. So you can see this is very important. So in the 16 months, we added additional 4 weeks of teacher assistantship over and above the 10 weeks of practical, right? And during this 4 weeks, they'll go to school 4 days a week, they'll come back to NIU 1 day a week, where we had about 46 hours of pedagogical practices module, and they are co-teached by the master teacher and the NIE lecturers. So they provide the theory and the practice. In the past, we used to have a pronunciation and communication skills, but that module was conducted for the English language teacher. But in the 16 months, we conducted this module for every teacher because we felt that every teacher needs to speak well, not just the English language teacher. Right, and some other modules. So it's important, this tripartite is actually indeed very important. Okay, next, we have different types of PD. The job-embedded PD will be the one where is the daily happening in the school, like mentoring, right, lesson observation, and things like that. And it cannot be one-off, it has to be sustained, and it has to be authentic. CEE, all right, so did a report, and in the report it talks about mentoring, learning communities, and courses. So this learning community is very structured. Okay, here we talk about, generally, our teaching workforce is quite young. Our mean age is about 36, and we actually have a very structured mentoring program. It's a two-year. That means every beginning teacher will have a mentor for a period of 2 years, and the academies will support the mentors for a period of 2 years, while they mentor the mentee that we supported by us for 2 years. And every school, we train 4, because each will look after 2 beginning teachers, like maximum 8 we send to a school. And what happened is that it's in our guidelines to principals that the mentors and the beginning teachers will be offloaded. And not only are they offloaded, they will have a common period in the timetable for them to have coaching sessions. No point giving them the time, but yet there's no time. Then if my free period doesn't coincide with your free period, there's no way we can actually meet, right? So it's about 1 to 1.5 hours a week per teacher. So if I have 2 teachers, it'll be 3 hours a week. So the offloading can come in different forms, because, in Singapore, we have different types of work. Face-to-face instruction, that is our teaching time. Co-curricular activities, our is school-based, not community-based, and community work. So the offloading can come in different forms, and not just only face-to-face instruction. So that's just the 201 PTABIS finding. Let me just go through this part. Okay, so we realized that for schools which have undergone our instruction mentor program, the teachers, they have a higher cognitive teacher perception, effective teacher perception, and also retention perception. Right, so they like what someone, and they dare to try out new methods of teaching. Here, this is the one where the journey of a beginning teacher, after the 2 years, when they are on their way to their third year, what we do is that we reconnect with them one more time. Because after that, they can no longer call themselves a beginning teacher. They are now an experienced teacher. Maybe it's time for them to mentor another person. Alright? Okay, this one we talk about communities, and communities are very important. Teachers generate, they utilize their own knowledge. They also make use of public knowledge, and they create new knowledge. And this new knowledge will in turn help them inform their own practice, and also they can share with others. So for these communities, what happened is that professional learning communities is in school. Every school is mandatory to have 1 hour a week just for this. Everyone will have a common period. They talk about nothing except teaching and learning. Not about housekeeping, not about grammar, going to have this meeting, that meeting, but it's really, and we have reached this stage, we have come a long way, where we have deprivatized our classroom. That means peer observation is very common, right? We are it's very common, and the teachers do videotape their lesson, and they can play it during a session for other teachers to give feedback. We are beginning to have this. Beyond school, we call them network learning communities. It can be by interest, subject, or roles. Interest means a group of us, we are very interested in learning studies. A group of us are very interested in lesson studies. Okay, we all come together for a network learning community on that. Or roles, a group of us, we are school staff developer. We have a common role, but we want to come together to share some of these best practices. So our PLCs, we have the three big ideas and four critical questions. I'm not sure if you're familiar with it. It's like, one of the questions will be, how do we know that our students have learned? What is it that they have not learned? What do if they have learned, what do we do? And they have not learned, what do we do? And we do have some tools for them, critical inquiry tools, for them to conduct the PLCs in a 1 hour a week. And we realize that when we have some of these things, it's really good because we have shared leadership. There's a higher level of professional discourse, and they are able to talk about the experts. Okay, I know some teachers may say that I'm only a teacher, I don't know whether I can contribute, but I just want to show you this is a compressed tower. A compressed tower? Yeah, when you put compressed tower in the water, it becomes like that. I mean, this is the actual tower. Actually, I have been sharing this, but I think that I was just telling myself I should just put one in the water and see how big it is. And so this is the tower from that, which means that you may think that you're very significant, but you're very insignificant, but your impact is very significant. Okay? I would just like to show an object lesson here about how when we work as a group, but I need a volunteer. Okay, Rashvia. So I give Rashvia a red ball. I have one red ball. I'm going to give this red ball to her. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So when we learn in a group, 1 plus 1 is equal to? Oh, she very clever. She says 3. This is an example of a subject chapter, and for the network learning community, this is familiar, but we added seeding and celebrating. Seeding is because the teachers come from different schools. So what happened is that because they come from different schools, you need time for the formation of the group. And celebrating here, it talks about share beyond, right? Okay, this is about some data on this. Now here, I would like to pause here to show you a video. In C2 PD, this is new to us, we took one of a typical school in the neighborhood, right? And we actually have a center for teaching and learning excellence. We started a center in that particular school, which is a very ordinary school in the neighborhood. The children are very ordinary. In fact, we don't need a very high cutoff to get in, but we want to show in situ training. Means like the master teacher will actually teach the students. Because in the academy, they just teach teachers, right? And the teachers pretend to be students, but here we teach students, it's very powerful. There are three types of PD. We have the master classes, where the master teacher will teach, the rest observe, the rest of the experience observed in a one-way mirror, one-way glass. And then what happens is that you go back and try out, and you come back again 3 months later to discuss what they've done. We have working with beginning teachers, or we also have working with experienced teachers. Let me just show you a video, which is just about a minute.
see and I do, I remember and understand better. I enjoy the lessons as I get to do investigative work with my friends. Sometimes our teachers will conduct demonstrations to help us improve our understanding. I also get to do hands-on activities with my classmates. At times, we use the Chromebook for collaboration. We share our observations and present our findings using whiteboarding. I like the interactions with my classmates as we have to explain it. When I see and I do, I remember and understand better. I enjoy the lessons as I get to do investigative work with my friends. Sometimes our teachers will conduct demonstrations to help us improve our understanding. I also get to do hands-on activities with my classmates. At times, we use the Chromebook for collaboration. We share our observations and present our findings using whiteboarding. I like the interactions with my classmates as we have to explain and justify to the class our group's answers. It also helps us to learn from one another and with our teacher's facilitation, our learning is enriched. I find this realistic and meaningful as I can connect what I read in textbooks with what I do. We work in teams and support one another's learning. Our teachers also ask questions to clarify and check our understanding. I look forward to all my science lessons.
Okay, this is an example of a lesson done in the Center for Teaching and Learning Excellence for a group of teachers and in situ. It means they really teach. Okay, moving forward. We would like every teacher to see not just yourself in the classroom, but yourself in a community, a network learning community. Okay, Skills Future. This is a national movement, learning throughout life and learning for life. So as a nation, we have this lifelong learner, and even our university, even in NIE, the modules, instead of one big chunk of like 1 year or so, we break down into modules, right? And it's a learn, work, learn kind of mentality. I would like to pause here, okay? And because for the teachers, I want to share with you one video, but before that, I want to show you okay. Alright, this is just a rubber band. Now what happened is this. This is our desired future. This is our current reality, the one at the bottom. If you are this rubber band, you'll feel very stretched and it will be very painful. So what you want to do is that you want to release this tension. Many of us tend to release the tension this way, which means we lower our standard. Right, we say it's too tough. If half of them are willing to come to school, I'm very happy. But when we do that, you know what happened? We abandon our vision, mission, and values. That's the price we have to pay. What we should do is keep this and bring the reality up. That means overcome some of these challenges as a group. We should be able to do that. Okay? And what happened is that. Well, not all things are like. So this is a stainless steel square frame. What shape would you like to see, but it's half? Without angles. Circle, very tough. When we encounter a problem, we have to tell ourselves that we need to reframe. We have to reframe. All right, not look at the problem from the same angle, but different. And even the most difficult shape. Yeah, so that is reframing, and that is the power of new questions. Okay, you want to see again? So this is the stainless steel square frame. All right, we just need to reframe and tell ourselves no problem so big that all of us cannot solve. All right? So, okay. Just show you this video of this boy from previous school. His name is Ashraf. He came to see me one day and says, Mrs. Chua, I want to study. And of course, I asked him, show me your PSLE results. Like, to join the school very easy, just show me that they failed the exam, they will let you in. But he says, I didn't even sit for the primary school reading exam. I says, huh? You didn't even sit for the paper? And then after that, she got a shock, she stepped back. Then I told myself, and he said that, I dropped out at primary four. And he said that he really wanted to study again. So I gave him a very simple test. Very badly he made it, and I said, okay, you just, I'll let you come in. Because there's no way out. He's too old for primary school, and he cannot get into any secondary school because he didn't have any primary school reading exam. On the first day, I noticed that he cried in the canteen. So I asked him, is it too tough for you? Anyone bullies you? Is it that you left school for a long time? He says, no. This morning when I put on the uniform, I cried because I thought I'll never be able to put on a uniform again. So I said, okay, that's a little high on those. And today, he not only finished his Institute of Technical Education, but he has actually completed the polytechnic, received a scholarship, he's doing national service, and when he comes up, he'll be able to start work straight away. Right now, I have a request for this particular video. You cannot take picture or videotape because I only have permission to show, but it's not to be captured. And he didn't even take sick for his exam because he comes from a very difficult family. He could see that there's no hope. Right? He's hopeless. He's like hopeless and totally had this hope. Okay? Done and then he started laughing. Okay? But because he met some fantastic teacher like all of you, all right, and even teacher educator, and now it's a case of endless hope. So the thing is, what I would like to say is this. Okay, later I'll teach you. What I would like to say is this. It's the same method of doing. It's just a different way of telling the story. Actually, all these are object lessons because you can forget all that I've shared, but you will not forget what you've seen. Because we are very visual. A lot of children come to us blank paper, right? Nothing fantastic. And sometimes you look at them, you say, are you sure you can add value to their life? You not only want to add value, you want to create value. So this is the blank paper. Actually, this one is like too close for comfort. Okay, so you ask yourself this question. Whether you are a teacher educator or a researcher, or a teacher, you ask yourself, what value do I want to create? Alright. When I come across the people who come into contact with. So this is 500 times. It is legal tender. It's a Hong Kong $500. So it's like you are adding value, not just but creating value. Okay. That's how I will show you how to do it. Yes, you have this paper. Right, so you tell a story. The story is the most important thing, it's not important. But so while you fold this, right, and you tell your story, you unfold this. Can you see? You unfold the $500 note. But I think when you do it, you use a smaller denomination. Right, and you just practice in front of the mirror a few times before you show it. Let me just end off with this as something to say that we come from different countries, they have different challenges, different contexts, and different needs. But we have the same mission. We want to bring out the best in our teachers because they will in turn bring out the best in our students. And when children learn, nations prosper. Right, and for us as educators, we put our heart into our mission because the mission is always in our heart. Right, with this, thank you very much.